Welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. I'm the RPG Chick. We're in the kitchen of Raedric's keep. We've explored some of this already. There's a lot of guards down here. I guess these guys must be very hungry. We only have one set of camping supplies left.
Eh?
So I'm... 1, 2, 3, 4, I'm hoping that we find some more. Otherwise we're going to have to head back to... what do you call it? Gilded Veil and buy some more without fulfilling our purpose. Which will stink. Oh, yeah, we haven't been this way? Oh, yeah, we kind of veered off that way. Okay, we still have yet to explore all of this. But let's head this way first. Oh! Another guard. They're all over the place here. A bunch of cockroaches. Shells included. Only made of steel or armor.
Yeah?
Can we go around the corner like that? And hit him?
Great.
Yeah. Ooh. Some good hits there, too. I'm glad we don't have to collect arrows. That would be so annoying. Knock down on him. Biggest problem I find in here is getting around each other in these corridors and the doorways. It's kind of difficult sometimes. I should even bother. Just have Aloth wait a sec.
Hmm.
Alarm, alarm! Now they're gonna come running, aren't they? Is there a reason we aren't all moving forward here? Who's this? Firebrand? Come on now. Are you stuck? Canna? Canna,
yeah.
Move over there. Okay. Problem here. See? Pathing problems.
Hmm?
Oh, chunkage.
Nice and slow.
Poleaxe, mail armor, helm. Normal stuff.
Of course.
Alright, switching back to ranged. There's gotta be some kind of macro for this. None of us have to level up yet, right? Once we do, we got a couple doors up top we can pick just to get experience. Are we all with range right now? Let me just make sure. Kind of distracted by the loud bird that likes to cheep at 4 in the morning. I'm the night owl, you're the bird, get it right. So we got a priest of Barath and a Raedric guard. Nice. And a sellsword as well. We're under attack! Thank you, Captain Obvious. Do the knockdown on him. If we're lucky, maybe we can get around each other this time. Arcane assault here. They're bound to pile up over there. What a hit? Mind bleeds? No. Amplified thrust. Off of Canna this time. He's right up front. And Yeah, once again, holy radiance.
How may I?
Nah, still having trouble getting around. Can you go here? Then you can attack him like that. See? I'm leading him by the hand, literally. I don't know if she can get through. Another arcane assault right there. And soul shock off of Canna. Since Canna's right where he's supposed to be. Armor of Faith.
Yeah.
That's annoying. Who is this? Firebrand? Okay, fine. Fine. Go ranged.
Yeah?
Why'd you run back here? He's soloing this guy. Can you run up and help, please? And I'm gonna have her switch to range too, because she's out of focus. And, magic missiles here. You know what? Is he the last one? Yeah, you know what? Let's have him switch to his scepter. Endurance. Ranged. Let's see if we can get this. This isn't what?
That's it!
Quickly and quietly.
A satisfying thud when they hit the ground. No trouble making your way through when we have to loot the bodies, huh? I noticed that. Okay, all the normal stuff. We gotta fill up? Let me see. Oh my god. Oh no, we can get more. We have one of one, and it's gonna make kind of unrealistic. Look at all the clothes we got. It's mostly simple clothing. That's hilarious.
If it makes you rest easier.
Oh, it'll make me rest easier if we all go inside, actually. Okay. A fine spear and a rod.
Yeah.
Not trapped, I hope. The Saint's War, Part 1, Overthrow. And 68 Silver Loose. Saint's War sounds vaguely familiar. I mean, I know we've heard about it. Do we have any books about it? Part 1. I'm guessing it might be the same color. But I'm checking them all just in case. Nope. Hold up, we got this. Admit's Hadrat. Okay. Well, let's just read this. The Saint's War, Part 1, Overthrow. There is much debate with historians as to when the Saint's War really began. It is widely accepted that the event that instigated it was the sanctuary flight of Red Saren citizens to the Deerwood. This led to a direct strife between the two nations that escalated into battle, the Saint's War. But it is the author's opinion that the war truly started many years before. After the miracle of the Verdant Vorlas, as it came to be known, Waidwen quickly gathered followers drawn to the stories of Aethys's miraculous prophet. You know how to say that now. At least I try to remember. His power grew. Eventually, Waidwen had gained enough support that he confronted the Imperial Governor. Assisted by a collection of knights and nobles who had been swayed to his cause, he marched on the capital city. The governor was allowed to live, but was forced to abdicate power and leave the colony. This was not from any understanding or easy acquiescence from the governor, but because of what happened when Waidwen entered the governor's palace. Okay, or not from any understanding or easy acquiescence from the governor, but because of what happened when Waidwen entered the governor's palace. I put the wrong emphasis there. As Waidwen approached the governor, according to accounts, his body turned into something that was no longer human. His flesh became luminescent and his head transformed into pure, blinding light. Other accounts suggest that Waidwen had become a being of light at an earlier time, when he was whipped in the public square. The outcome of his visit to the palace, however, is uncontested. The governor, knowing there was no way he could oppose an avatar of Aethys, relinquished his power. The people then asked Waidwen to lead the colony. He accepted, earning him the name Defiant King of Red Saras. Waidwen's rule was virtually uncontested. Initially, this was because everyone was awed that a god had chosen to manifest himself and lead his people. This changed as Waidwen became punishing the allies of the old empire and the poison on the world, what he considered corrupt churches or church leaders of Aethys. Scrutiny escalated, and soon worshippers of Aethys were also being punished for mere perceptions of heresy. Members of other religions were also added to the list of the persecuted for following different faiths. This caused large segments of the population to flee Red Saras for the Deerwood, begging for sanctuary. This caused strife between the two nations. The people of the Deerwood knew they could not sustain explosive population growth if Widewind's rule were to continue unchecked. They also feared that his eye would turn from Red Saras and land on them next if nothing was done. This was exactly what ultimately happened, and open war broke out as Waidwen moved to spread his dominion into the lands of Deerwood. Cool. Alright. No secrets to be found in this special room. Hey, these guys are kind of tough. They, you know, after a few battles with them, wearing us down, really. Interesting. Now we've still got an area back over here as well. This, we were in this place. We might come around full circle though. Maybe not in this episode though. Oop. A cell sword right there. There's a very open area. Oh, I don't want to take that. No. Hope she doesn't take that. I didn't mean to. Click that. Yep. Okay, good.
Yeah.
Intruders! Paladin of Barath. Paladin of Barath. Spell right? Ooh. And a cell sword who's like more than halfway dead. And hopefully no one running out from this way. This is going to be a pretty tough fight, so Necrotic Lance on this Spellrite. Knock down on that guy. Hold up. Whoa, whoa. That was weird. I'm just trying to switch weapons on this guy. Thank you. can do that. Oh, I'm not sure if Kenna's gonna be able to get through. No, I can't get through at the moment. Okay, Kenna. Oh my god. Not good. Kenna, use your thing. Your arquebus. Hit that guy. We definitely need some healing around here. Where is she? Firebrand right here. Miss, huh? Okay. Maybe we'll get to her in time. Really early in the battle for her to be, you know, brought out already. Oh, the spell right hit Firebrand with a necrotic lance. Ouchies. We can't see. What? We need to see for that spell? Why can't we see? It's right in line of sight. He looks like he is. Soul shock off of Eater. And, Eater. Knockdown. Alright. She's out. She's out. We need to take out this freaking soul sword who's like almost dead. Eater, please knock the guy down. Necrotic lance again on who? Near death. Yeah, him. Oh, he is knocked down. Never mind. Shield. Intruders are here! Could she even get through? Probably not. Good. Uh-oh. Aloth. What are you doing up here, front row? Can't even move either. Is he stuck? He's blocked. Can't go anywhere. Well, this is fast. Try to go like that. Maybe we'll get all of them. Maybe he won't be interrupted since it's a quick spell or ability, what have you. He's out of knockdowns. More healing their way. Try to take this paladin out. Oh, he's focused his attention away. Good. I say go again. Select them all? Barely, right? Still has yet to cast it. Healing? Oh, he must have... It's in process now, actually. Blessing. What is he like? Aeloth, move over here. This way. Theodess can actually wade into battle. Wait. Aeloth, no, you're staying here. Theodess is wading into battle. And this way, Canna might actually be able to make it through.
Yes?
Good. Let a big guy through here. Oh boy. Pause. Heal. Damn. Little heal.
But
both these guys are almost dead. Of course, our two guys are getting injured as well. Necrotic Lance. They're gonna fall any second, so hit this guy with Necrotic Lance. And he's out of stuff, so might as well just have him attack range.
Lava will be on seek.
Miss? Don't miss. Damn, now he's out of them. Wait, what are we doing? That guy fell, right? Can you, like, go through and attack him? Thank you. Endurance, yeah, ranged. Oh, she can actually use a spell again. Soul Shock off of Canna. Magic missile on this guy. Take him out. Tough, man. He's really tough. Alright. Guess what? You're doomed. Who else is here? Durance? Yeah, you can... You know what? Switch to your staff. Run in. Good. Oh, Aeloth actually killed him. Wow.
I'll see what I can find.
Some battle. Leather armor, acorn helms, okay. That was tough. Wow. Ooh, Spellwright's Tome. Give to our Aeloth. Great swords, pole axes, fine robe, plate armor, mail, capes, full helm, hood, and plenty o' money.
You can trust me.
Maybe. Yep. I guess it's unlimited. I figured this was all we had, you know, that it would be full after that. But I guess we don't ever fill up, do we?
Yeah.
Oh, there's another. Oh no. Okay. I gotta look at the spellbook. Wizard's Double. Consul Heart's Parasitic Staff. Creates a glowing quarterstaff of pure energy for the wizard to wield, granting a bonus chance to hit and giving the wizard endurance with each successful strike. So it summons a weapon, Consul Heart's Parasitic Quarterstaff, for 58.5 seconds. That's pretty cool. Jolting Touch. A bolt of electricity jumps from the caster's fingers to the nearest enemy, and then to the next nearest, causing decreasing amounts of shock damage. Miasma of Dull-Mindedness attacks will. Minus 10 perception, area of effect, minus 10 intellect, minus 10 resolve, versus will. Plus 10 accuracy for that. A cloud of heavy fog settles in the minds of those in the area's effect. Dulling senses and wits inflicts penalties to perception, intellect, and resolve. Consul Heart's Corrosive Siphon. Eats away at the target spirit, inflicting corrosive damage and converting that essence into endurance for the caster. Foe area of effect drains 56.5 corrode damage as endurance. Over 13 seconds versus fortitude. And Rolling Flame. Oh yeah, there's a spell like this for D&D. Creates a rebounding ball of fire, inflicting burn damage upon anyone in its path. You've got some pretty good spells. Very interesting stuff. 5-meter jump. 21 to 32 burn versus reflex. Cool. I gotta figure out what to do with these tomes. I don't think you can transfer spells into one or the other, so it's gonna be like, I don't know what we're gonna do. I know we can switch the tomes, and that takes a certain amount of time. Alright.
Eh?
Kinda waste time during combat. Okay, there's a big door there. These are all doors. So I'm guessing people don't come out of doors. We only go indoors, and they can't hear us through doors. Apparently. There's a lot of doors. This one's... Ooh, that one's really tough to get through. Hello? Can we look at that? No. We can't get through that. Wait a second. Can we get through this one? How many doors? Three, right? Save here. That was tough indeed. You know what, though? Aren't we out of spells? Let me find that out.
Hi?
Oh, this way. Yeah. Well, he's got first level spells.
What?
He's out of healing. We gotta camp again. This is our last camping. Ay, ay, ay. These battles are very tough, you know?
If it makes you rest easier.
No, I want all of us. That will make me rest easier. Get in the room. I'm tired of dealing with you people. Getting stuck everywhere. Ooh. getting peeks. Let's examine the rest of the rooms. No one in here? Cool. Nice change of pace. Saint Waidwen, farmer become god. With the mention of the name Waidwen, most folk think only one word, Godhammer. While this event echoes through the ages and is still felt years after the destruction of Evanduer Bridge, Widwin's humble beginnings belie the powerful force he would grow into. Waidwen lived an unassuming life in a remote area of Red Saras, the son of Vorlas farmers. He toiled in the fields alongside his father for 22 years until his father's death. The farm then fell to him to run. He considered selling, but he had no other skills upon which to draw, so he set on the path of the Vorlas farmer as well. Nothing of note has been recorded in Widwin's life until 2 years after his father's death. One day, while working the fields, Widwin's life was irrevocably changed. In his words, night was falling, the fingers of dusk already gripping the sky. The sun had dipped behind the world's edge, and stars were peeking from beyond the shroud. The day was still, and darkness had blanketed the field. I placed my last harvest of the day into the collections pile when from behind me arose a brilliant light. I turned, fear in my breast, knowing not what could have caused such intense radiance. Behind me stood a blazing figure, resplendent in glory. Its white flesh glowed with a luminescent radiance, its head a blinding ball of light, brighter than the highest sun of mid-year. I averted my gaze, afraid I would be struck down for daring to gaze upon such a creature. Oh, whoa. This is a long tale, huh? A sudden peace washed over me, sweeping away my fear, leaving my troubled soul tranquil. A loving warmth wrapped its arms around me. A voice spoke to me as I stood, transfixed, trying to both see this glorious being and avoid its dazzling scrutiny. "Fear not," it said to me, "for you are chosen above all others. You will be the light to bring about the rebirth of an empire." It then held out its hand and bestowed upon me a vision of power such that I could scarcely contain it. Waidwen, disheveled and dirty, stumbled into his village the next morning, telling all who had listened upon the miracle that happened in his fields. Aethas himself, he claimed, had appeared to him. He was to punish the Edirian governor for leading his people into ruin. A way would be provided, and those faithful who helped would be blessed when the divinity manifested, or blessed. Villagers ignored him, convinced the loss of his parents had broken his mind. But Waidwen continued to preach of the power of Aethas and the corruption of the governor, eventually earning him the ire of the locals. His confrontations with the villagers hit a turning point one day in mid-autumn. A crowd had gathered around Waidwen, jeering him and telling him to leave the village. The Vorlas crop that season was particularly light, and the villagers blamed Waidwen, saying he had angered the gods, particularly Aethas, with his blasphemy. They backed him into one of the withered fields, yelling at him to go. Accounts of the inciting action are hazy. Some say a stone was thrown, others say he was pushed. Others still say he simply tripped over a dry root sticking from the ground. Regardless of the cause, Waidwen landed face down onto the ground, the villagers standing over him laughing. "Enough!" a voice, not Widwin's, boomed across the field. Waidwen looked up at the crowd, his eyes glowing with a blinding white light. He stood, but did not stand. One moment he was on the ground, and the next he was standing before the crowd, who cowered before him. "You dare deny me?" the voice spoke through Widwin's mouth. "You dare refuse my servant?" Widwin's arms raised, beginning to luminesce. "You dare require proof?" His arms went out to his sides. "Never ask again, lest you be burned in the light of the new dawn." There was a flash of light from Widwin's eyes and hands, and the entire field sprang to life. The once dried and brittle plants became full, lush, and verdant. The crowd was silent. From somewhere in the back came a call of "Praise Aethas," and then they all fell to their knees in front of Waidwen, farmer turned god. Cool. And here? The Deerwood Part 4, Hadrit's Rebellion. Alright, we still need 3. The joints are fringed with rust. The emblem on the breastplate is of a tree with broad heart-shaped leaves. Now, what about this? A potion of minor regeneration. And 221 Capra Pans. I don't really use these. But, yeah, she could use them. Okay, found a secret here.
That's unusual.
Not going in there yet. Not this episode. Naasitaq Poetry, a compilation. I'll read this one, then we'll be done for this episode, guys. The expedition. I move. There is no compulsion. It is not a need, but something pulls. I cannot deny its draw. The white wends out past my vision. Its fierce eyes watch me as I move. The wolf tracks my step, a silent companion who will not join. All is blank. The pale expanse lies before and behind. I search. The miles pass, and still my feet move. My hunt continues unabated. The landscape returns my gaze, unaffected by my presence. The snow falls, needles driven by the wind. Its cold teeth bite my skin. The snow gathers, its hands around my feet. A fierce opponent who will not relent. All is white. My journey continues. I travel. I can no longer stop. A true compulsion forms. The need drives me on. I must see. The sun breaks through the gray. Its unrelenting gaze thaws me. My body warms under its touch. Frigid limbs move again and carry me farther. All is empty. The breath of existence is my destination. Pretty interesting. Alright. So we're going in here next. Now what, did we come down here thinking this was just a kitchen? Thanks for watching. See you in the next episode. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.